Hi, I'm Jackie Bernard, Programs Assistant at Uncodon's Cabin Historic Site, the home of Josiah Hansen. And I am so excited to share with you a series of videos we film called Discovering Dawn. The short videos are a look at the contributions that African Canadians have made to the development of my hometown, Dresden, Ontario. The town was a final destination for hundreds of refugees from American slavery. We had the pleasure of working with local historian Marie Carter.
Well, Jackie, here we are on the corner of Tecumseh and Main Street in Dresden, and we have this lovely 1870s style Victorian building behind us, which is a commercial building. And it has been designated by the Chatham-Kent Conservancy group that says that this is an important building both architecturally and because of its history, of its links to members of that were involved with the Underground Railroad. And so we can't say for certain that this building was built by one of those individuals, but certainly they were a strong presence on this street during the time that this building was built. We do know that there was a blacksmith shop that was located in this area, and that later this was a white smithy, so it's possible that that earlier blacksmith shop was also in this building. And then later this became a carriage shop, and the really interesting thing about this is that they built the carriages on the upper floor of this building, not down below as you would expect. And then when the carriage was completed, they would put boards from the second story down to the parking lot in the rear, and they would roll the carriages off down that way, which is really a strange way of doing things, but that's what they did. But anyway, you can still see in the peak of the building that it still says shoeing, which tells us very clearly that this is a blacksmith's building. What is most important about the building, though, is it's part of a thriving black business community that existed here in Dresden during the time from about 1853 all the way up to the turn of the century. Now, it evolved a lot over that time, but in the 1850s was really the heyday. And during that time, the dominant people on this side of the street, which was Old Fairport, Main Street was the demarcation point between two communities that butted up together here. This side is Old Fairport, which has very little black settlement except for along this road, and the other side of the street, which was the original survey of Dresden, which had three quarters of those lots on that side of the street were black owned, along with nearly 100% of the second survey of Dresden further down the street. So you see there was a huge presence here and great ownership of these things, of this land base that was here. The other thing that's really important to remember is that not everybody who came here was a slave. Everybody who came here had very diverse kind of backgrounds. And so we have that whole migration of freemen that came after the 1850 Slave Act, Fugitive Slave Act. And among the group of people who had been free before they came here, they had professions and they had trades before they came here. So we had people like blacksmiths and shoemakers and barbers, which were a very important person in the community because they not only cut your hair, but they were kind of did first aid type of thing, minor kind of surgery, and also were fashion setters. So anyhow, we have individuals like that, and also what a lot of people don't know is Dresden's very first doctor was a black doctor, and he lived along the street as well, not too far from here. So, but we think that this property may have been associated with a woman who came here. His name was Mary Smith. Mary's husband, Stephen Smith, lived right next door to William Whipper. Well, we think there may be a family connection, but we haven't been able to definitively prove it yet. But we know that Mary was widowed when she left Pennsylvania and came here, and she owned two or three properties in Dresden, and among them was a grocery store that she ran. Now, we also know that Mary was very prominent because when the Freedmen's Inquiry came to town, she lent them her pleasure carriage so that they could tour around the town.
Interesting.
Yes, yes. Very interesting woman. And she was also a major supporter of Reverend Thomas Hughes's church and gave him, when he first came to town, the upper floor of her grocery store to hold his church and his school. And Hughes referred to that as his upper room school, which is a nice take on the idea of the Lord's Last Supper,
yes.
Right? Yes. So anyhow, so Mary was not alone here, of course. As I said, if you go and look across the street, she came here with her sons, Stephen and William. And this little yellow house that's across the street is actually a remnant of a larger structure that was here that was Stephen and William's barbershop. And on this street then, as I said, you would have had a blacksmith who was about in the location of where the modern post office is today. Josiah Henson owned a property two doors down from this next to what is now the town center. And as we go down the street, there were also other businesses, including William Whipper's flour mill and another interesting property that was owned by Mary Smith's husband, her second husband, who was J.B. Hollingsworth. And if you want to come with me down the street, I'll show you a plaque that was raised on the Trillium Trail to J.B. Hollingsworth and tell you a bit about him, because he's a very interesting character. So it's really interesting to walk down this street, isn't it, Jackie, to envision some of these businesses that were once here and to know that there was this presence of these Pennsylvania freemen who lent so much of their talent and their entrepreneurial ability and to the development of the town. And I think one of the really interesting people is Mary Smith's second husband. His name is James Burns Hollingsworth. And James was one of these people where you can really see over time how people really were in a time of tremendous change where they really had to adapt. James himself was widowed twice, and so Mary was his third wife. And he had raised two families prior to that, and had been the real estate agent for William Whipper, who had so much property here, three quarters of the town almost. And so James had gone from that role, with Whipper leaving town and no longer having his properties to manage. He reinvented himself again when he married Mary Smith and became a grocer. And so you'll see that in the census records that he lists himself as a grocer. And then later on, you get this really curious designation of James as a confectioner. Now, a confectioner in those days was not only somebody who made candy, but they were involved in making of things like ice cream. And in fact, James created the very first ice cream parlor for Dresden. And he did it on this site right here. And there's now a plaque commemorating James's contributions along with some of the freed population that were here. What's really significant about this site, and it really shows you a little bit of James's entrepreneurial spirit, is that it's located right across from the main town dock where the excursion boats in the 1880s, 1890s used to park. You can see the clients from that disembarking, coming up this slope, and it's been a hot summer day and they've been out at Walpole Island on one of the Sunday school picnics or something of this nature, and they're thirsty and they're hungry, coming up, and there's James with his ice cream. And I think it's just wonderful to show us how, you know, we had these really imaginative, even in the naming of the ice cream parlor, which is called Sweet Briar Cottage. So I think it tells you a lot about James's character. Now, James also is quite interesting because he's one of the last of the Pennsylvania freemen to be a presence here from that original group that was here during the Underground Railroad period. And James and Mary Smith, his third wife, they both stayed here till pretty much the turn of the 20th century. And James himself ends up to be quite elderly, and in his later part of his life, he goes blind. And he decides to go and take up the offer of his daughter, Annie, who in the interim has moved to Cocana, Wisconsin. And he spends the rest of his days at Annie's and eventually dies of a stroke, unfortunately, in Annie's care. Now, his wife, meantime, goes to Detroit to be with her family and William Smith and her grandson, Stephen, was later called Levere, were living in Detroit, so she goes to be with them for a time. And then, for some reason, which we haven't determined yet, she moves to Cape May, New Jersey, and that's where Mary dies. So you can see this wonderful kind of the inventiveness while they're here, the dedication to the community, but then also this travel and change that's so much part of their life, which I find really fascinating.
It is very fascinating.